that a kindergarten in Siberia, omitting the most important fact, it's a prison for children of political prisoners. Another greatest example of monumental idiocy of American politicians. Edward Kennedy was in Moscow, and he thought that he is a popular, charismatic American politician who is easygoing, who can smile, dance at the wedding in Russian Palace of Marriages. What he did not understand, or maybe he pretended not to understand, that actually he was being taken for a ride. This is a staged wedding, especially to impress foreign media or useful idiots like Ed Kennedy. Most of the guests there, they had security clearance, and they were instructed what to say to foreigners. This is exactly what I was doing. You can see me in the same damn wedding palace in Moscow where Ed Kennedy was dancing here. You see, smiling. He thinks he's very smart. From the viewpoint of Russian citizens who observe this idiocy, he's narrow-minded, egocentrical idiot who tries to earn his own popularity through participation in propaganda farces like this. Here you can see myself. On the right, again, exemplary Soviet bride. On the left, three journalists from various countries, Asia, Africa, and Latin America. Obviously, they enjoying the situation. They will go back home and write the reports. We were present on a regular Soviet wedding. They were not present on a regular Soviet wedding. They were present. They were part of a farce, of a circus performance. Another thing which I had to, sometimes risking my life, to explain to foreigners. Time magazine, for example, is very critical of South African racist regime. The whole article was dedicated to the shameful internal passport system where blacks are not allowing to live with whites. For some strange reason, for the last 14 years since my defection, nobody wanted to pay attention to my passport. This is my passport. It also shows my nationality, and it has a police rubber stamp, which is called propiska in Russian language, which assigns me to a certain area of residence. I cannot leave that area, same way as this black man cannot leave the area in South Africa. Yet we call South African government racist regime. Not a single Jane Schmonda or Fonda is brave enough, courageous enough to come to media and say, look, this is what happens in USSR. I send a copy of my passport to many American liberals and civil rights defenders and all the other useful idiots. They never bothered to answer me back. This shows what kind of integrity, what kind of honesty these people are. They're a bunch of hypocrites because they don't want to recognize a good example of racism in my country. This is the first stage of befriending a professor. You can see myself on the left with the same James Bond smile. On the right is my KGB supervisor, Comrade Leonid Mitrokhin, and in the middle, a professor of political science in Delhi University. The next stage would be to invite him to a gathering of Indo-Soviet Friendship Society. There he is, sitting next to his wife, before he is being sent to USSR for a free trip. Everything is paid by the Soviet government. He was made to believe that he is invited to USSR because he is a talented, sober-thinking intellectual. Absolutely false. He is invited because he is a useful idiot, because he would agree and subscribe to most of the Soviet propaganda cliché. And when he is coming back to his own country, he is going for years and years to teach the beauties of Soviet socialism to newer and newer generations of his students, thus promoting the Soviet propaganda line. The KGB was even curious about this gentleman. It may look innocent. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, a great spiritual leader, or maybe a great charlatan and crook, depending on which, from which side you are looking at him. Beatles were trained at his ashram in Hardwar in India how to meditate. Mia Farrow and other useful idiots from Hollywood visited his school, and they returned back to United States absolutely zonked out of their minds with marijuana, hashish, and crazy ideas of meditation. To meditate, in other words, to isolate oneself from the current social and political issues of your own country, to get into your own bubble, to forget about troubles of the world. Obviously, KGB was very fascinated with such a beautiful school, such a brainwashing center for stupid Americans. I was dispatched by the KGB to check what kind of VIP Americans attend this school.
That's you on the left.
Yes, right? I'm on the left. I was trying to get enrolled in that school. Unfortunately, the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi asked too much. He wanted $500 American for enrollment. But my function was not actually to get enrolled in the school. My function was to discover what kind of people from the United States attend this school. And we discovered that, yes, there are some influential members of family, public opinion makers of United States, who come back with the crazy stories about Indian philosophy. Indians themselves look upon them as idiots, useful idiots. To say nothing about KGB, who looked at them as extremely naive, misguided people. Obviously, a VIP, say a wife of a congressman, or a prominent Hollywood personality, after being trained in that school, is much more instrumental in the hands of manipulators of public opinion and KGB than a normal person who understands, who looks through this type of fake religious training.
Why would they be more susceptible to manipulation?
I just mentioned that because, you see, a person who is too much involved in introspective meditation. You see, if you carefully look what Maharishi Mahesh Yogi is teaching to Americans, is that most of the problems, most of the burning issues of today can be solved simply by meditating. Don't rock the boat. Don't get involved. Just sit down, look at your navel and meditate. And the things, due to some strange logic, due to cosmic vibration, will settle down by themselves. This is exactly what the KGB and Marxist-Leninist propaganda wants from Americans, to distract their opinion, attention, and mental energy from real issues of the United States into a non-issues, into a non-world, non-existent harmony. Obviously, it's more beneficial for the Soviet aggressors to have a bunch of duped Americans than Americans who are self-conscious, healthy, physically fit, and alert to the reality. Mm-hmm. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi obviously is not on the payroll of the KGB. But whether he knows it or not, he contributes greatly to demoralization of American society. And he's not the only one. There are hundreds of those gurus who come to your country to capitalize on naivete and stupidity of Americans. It's a fashion. It's a fashion to meditate. It's a fashion not to be involved. So obviously, you can see that if KGB were that curious, if they paid my trip to Hardwar, if they assigned me to that strange job, obviously they were very much fascinated. They were convinced that that type of brainwashing is very efficient and instrumental in demoralization of the United States.
Our conversation with Yuri Alexandrovich Bezmianov, who is a defector from the Soviet Union, a former propaganda agent for Novosti and the KGB, will continue after this message.
This picture shows the part of the building of USSR embassy and my supervisors. On the left is Comrade Mehdi, an Indian communist, and on the right, Comrade Mitrokhin, my supervisors in the secret department of research and counter-propaganda. It has nothing to do with either research or counter-propaganda. Most of the activity of that department was to compile huge amount, volume of information on individuals who were instrumental in creating public opinion. Publishers, editors, journalists, actors, educationalists, professors of political science, members of parliament, representatives of business circles. Most of these people were divided roughly in two groups. those who would tow the Soviet foreign policy, they would be promoted to the positions of power through media and public opinion manipulation. Those who refused the Soviet influence in their own country would be character assassinated or executed physically, come revolution. Same way as in the small town of Hue in South Vietnam, several thousands of Vietnamese were executed in one night when the city was captured by Viet Cong for only 2 days. And American CIA could never figure out how could possibly communists know each individual, where he lives, where to get him, and would be arrested in one night, basically in some 4 hours before dawn, put on a van, taken out of the city limits, and shot. The answer is very simple. Long before communists occupied the city, there was extensive network of informers, local Vietnamese citizens, who knew absolutely everything about people who are instrumental in public opinion, including barbers and taxi drivers. Everyone who was sympathetic to the United States was executed. Same thing was done under the guidance of the Soviet embassy in Hanoi, and same thing I was doing in New Delhi. To my horror, I discovered that in the files where people were doomed to execution, there were names of pro-Soviet journalists with whom I was personally friendly.
Pro-Soviet?
Yes. They were idealistically minded leftists who made several visits to USSR. And yet, the KGB decided that come revolution or drastic changes in political structure of India, they will have to go.
Why is that?
Because they know too much. Mm-hmm. Simply because, you see, the useful idiots, the leftists who are idealistically believing in the beauty of Soviet socialist or communist or whatever system, when they get disillusioned, they become the worst enemies. That's why my KGB instructors specifically made the point, never bother with leftists. Forget about these political prostitutes. Aim higher. This was my instruction. Try to get into large circulation, established conservative media. Reach, filthy rich movie makers, intellectuals, so-called academic circles. Cynical, egocentric people who can look into your eyes with angelic expression and tell you a lie. These are the most recruitable people, people who lack moral principles, who are either too greedy or too suffer from self-importance. They feel that they matter a lot. These are the people who KGB wanted very much to recruit.
But to eliminate the others, to execute the others, don't they serve some purpose? Wouldn't they be the ones they rely on?
They serve purpose only at the stage of destabilization of a nation. For example, your leftists in the United States, all these professors and all these beautiful civil rights defenders, they are instrumental in the process of the subversion only to destabilize the nation. When their job is completed, They are not needed anymore. They know too much. Some of them, when they get disillusioned, when they see that Marxist-Leninists has come to power, obviously they get offended. They think that they will come to power. That will never happen, of course. They will be lined up against the wall and shot. But they may turn into the most bitter enemies of Marxist-Leninists when they come to power. And that's what happened in Nicaragua. You remember most of these former Marxist-Leninists were either put to prison or one of them split and now he's working against Sandinistas. It happened in Grenada when Maurice Bishop was already a Marxist. He was executed by a new Marxist who was more Marxist than this Marxist. Same happened in Afghanistan when first there was Taraki, he was killed by Amin, then Amin was killed by Babrak Karmal with the help of KGB. Same happened in Bangladesh when Mujibur Rahman, very pro-Soviet leftist, was assassinated by his own Marxist-Leninist military comrades. It's the same pattern everywhere. The moment they serve their purpose, all the useful idiots are used either